1 Kings chapter 7. It took Solomon another 13 years to finish building his own palace complex. He built the Palace of the Forest of Lebanon 150 feet long, 75 feet wide, and 45 feet high. There were four rows of cedar columns supporting 45 cedar beams, 15 in each row, and then roofed with cedar. Windows in groupings of three were set high in the walls on either side. All the doors were rectangular and arranged symmetrically. He built a colonnaded courtyard 75 feet long and 45 feet wide. It had a roof porch at the front with ample eaves. He built a courtroom, the Hall of Justice, where he would decide judicial matters, and paneled it with cedar. He built his personal residence behind the hall on a similar plan. Solomon also built another one just like it for Pharaoh's daughter, whom he had married. No expense was spared. Everything here, inside and out, from foundation to roof, was constructed using high-quality stone, accurately cut and shaped and polished. The foundation stones were huge, ranging in size from 12 to 15 feet, and of the very best quality. The finest stone was used above the foundation, shaped to size and trimmed with cedar. The courtyard was enclosed with a wall made of three layers of stone and topped with cedar timbers, just like the one in the porch of the temple of God. King Solomon sent to Tyre and asked Hiram, not the king, another Hiram, to come. Hiram's mother was a widow from the tribe of Naphtali. His father was a Tyrian and a master worker in bronze. Hiram was a real artist. He could do anything with bronze. He came to King Solomon and did all the bronze work. First, he cast two pillars in bronze, each 27 feet tall and 18 feet in circumference. Then he cast two capitals in bronze to set on the pillars. Each capital was 7.5 feet high and flared at the top in the shape of a lily. Each capital was dressed with an elaborate filigree of 7 braided chains and a double row of 200 pomegranates, setting the pillars off magnificently. He set the pillars up in the entrance porch to the temple. The pillar to the south he named Security, Yachin, and the pillar to the north, Stability, Boaz. The capitals were in the shape of lilies. When the pillars were finished, Hiram's next project was to make the sea, an immense round basin of cast metal, 15 feet in diameter, 7.5 feet tall, and 45 feet in circumference. Just under the rim, there were two bands of decorative gourds, 10 to each foot and a half. The gourds were cast in one piece with the sea. The sea was set on 12 bowls, 3 facing north, 3 facing west, 3 facing south, and 3 facing east. The bowls faced outward, supporting the sea on their hindquarters. The sea was 3 inches thick and flared out at the rim like a cup or like a lily. It held about 11,500 gallons. Hiram also made 10 washstands of bronze. Each was 6 feet square and 4.5 feet tall. They were made like this. Panels were fastened to the uprights. Lions, bulls, and cherubim were represented on the panels and uprights. Beveled wreath work bordered the lions and bulls above and below. Each stand was mounted on 4 bronze wheels with bronze axles. The uprights were cast with decorative relief work. Each stand held a basin on a circular engraved support, 1.5 feet deep, set on a pedestal 2.25 feet square. The washstand itself was square. The axles were attached under the stand and the wheels fixed to them. The wheels were 27 inches in diameter, and they were designed like chariot wheels. Everything, axles, rims, spokes, and hubs, was of cast metal. and the handles cast in one piece with the stand. At the top of the washstand, there was a ring about 9 inches deep. The uprights and handles were cast with the stand. Everything and every available surface was engraved with cherubim, lions, and palm trees, bordered by arabesques. The washstands were identical, all cast in the same mold. He also made 10 bronze wash basins, each 6 feet in diameter with a capacity of 230 gallons, one basin for each of the 10 washstands. He arranged 5 stands on the south side of the temple and 5 on the north. The sea was placed at the southeast corner of the temple. Hiram then fashioned the various utensils, buckets and shovels and bowls. Hiram completed all the work he set out to do for King Solomon on the temple of God. 2 pillars, 2 capitals on top of the pillars, 2 decorative filigrees for the capitals, 400 pomegranates for the 2 filigrees, a double row of pomegranates for each filigree, 10 washstands, each with its own wash basin, 1 sea, 12 bowls under the sea, miscellaneous buckets, shovels, and bowls. All these artifacts that Hiram made for King Solomon for the temple of God were of burnished bronze. He cast them in clay in a foundry on the Jordan plain between Succoth and Zarephath. These artifacts were never weighed. They were far too many. Nobody has any idea how much bronze was used. Solomon was also responsible for all the furniture and accessories in the temple of God. The gold altar, the gold table that held the bread of the presence, the pure gold candelabras, 5 to the right and 5 to the left in front of the inner sanctuary, the gold flowers, lamps, and tongs, the pure gold dishes, wick trimmers, sprinkling bowls, ladles, and censers, the gold sockets for the doors of the inner sanctuary, the Holy of Holies, used also for the doors of the main sanctuary. That completed all the work King Solomon did on the temple of God. He then brought in the items consecrated by his father David, the silver and the gold and the artifacts. He placed them all in the treasury of God's temple. May the Lord bless the reading of his word and guide my mouth as I speak the message that I prepared. Let it be his message, not my message. And his will might be done, not mine. That he might receive glory and honor, not I. And all those with ears might hear the words of the Lord. Amen. My sermon this morning is entitled, Life is Made Up of Details, or Just Eat the Pie, P.I. No, we'll get there. Anyway, sometimes when you tell somebody that you're reading the Bible, you sometimes will get this very skeptical, oh, it's all a bunch of myths and made up, and, you know, it's all this, miraculous gobbledygook, and who could ever read something like that? It's got no basis in reality whatsoever. In the event that you should encounter somebody who gives you that sort of, static, here's a good word for you, I haven't heard that in a while, I suggest you open up to the book of Kings and read them in 1 Kings 7, because this does not read like something that was just sort of made up by somebody's imagination. I once was responding to an accident, and here between the two villages, guys, the road curves, but they went straight to a telephone pole. We got there, and the first thing it said is, an animal ran out in front, so we swerved to miss it. Not a cat, not a dog, not a brown animal, not a deer, just an animal. Okay then, buddy, sure it was an animal that swerved. Picture it in your mind. And so one of the things that sure, Evelyn, you were going, boy, there are no hymns about how much bronze, Hiram of Tyre used for it. No. But there's a specificity to it that reminds us that the Bible is based in reality. I mean, you don't know how much the pew you're sitting on weighs, but it weighs something, right? There's a specificity to life that the Bible speaks to because it's based in reality. It's a real story, it's real stories about real lives. And one thing, actually, the hymn you picked, the beautiful for situation, is the joy of the whole earth, is Mount Zion on the sides of the north. You know, Jerusalem has a specific place on a specific mountain. This is the place where God reveals himself and moves. The temple, the palace of Solomon, these are all, specific places. If some of you will remember when people used to, come to Cavendish and they'd ask, where does Solzhenitsyn live? Right? The sign used to say at the store, no public restroom and no directions to Solzhenitsyn's house. Right? I've been known to tell people, just drive around and tell people you saw it. You can't really see it from the road anyway, so just don't worry about it. But we all know there was a specific house where he actually lived and wrote and did stuff. Some of you know where it is, and we don't. It's okay. There's a specific nature to the revelation of God. When God speaks to you, when God does something for you, when God works in your life, you have a particular location in space and time that God reveals. There's a reality to it. It's not just, I had a thought. Well, where were you when you had that thought? Where were you when God healed you? Where were you when God revealed his truth to you? Might have been in the basement of a church someplace, right? Cinder block walls and yellow paint. There's a specificity to this. And now, having said that, in verse 26, people get all excited because it says that the sea, the big tank, is 45 feet in circumference and 15 feet in diameter. All right, you smart people, what's the problem with that? That means that the ratio of a circle, pi, is 3, right? Okay, so it's not quite 15. It's actually, 15 plus another 1.4 times the other. It's a little bit more. But, and so sometimes people like to point at this and go, see, the Bible's wrong here. Because it says that, it can't be true because they measured it wrong. Lord John, right? The Lord knows people measure things wrong all the time. Yeah, just ask the machinist, how long something is. He'll give it to you in 64ths of an inch. Right? I don't ever use a 64th of an inch. My measurements are always wrong. Some of you are saying, yeah, Pastor, we've worked with you before, we know. Right? It's generally that much, especially if you're using a cubit, right? That's the distance from your arm or from your elbow to your hand. How many cubits is this thing? I feel like Mr. Bob. It's a basic description. When I took the SATs, they actually taught us that don't use 3.1 or 3.4 or 1.4 or 3.145 or 577 over 113. That's what the Egyptians used for the ratio of circle to pi. When I took the SATs, they said just use 3 because you've got a multiple choice of 4 answers, and so 3 will get you close enough, and then you can adjust there as to which one you're closer to. It's close enough because it's describing something not with a machinist blueprint. It's somebody looking at it and trying to tell you, give you a picture of what it actually looked like. It's close. But it has a ring of authenticity that makes us, go, I can sort of picture it in my mind. 45 feet around, 15 feet across. Yeah, I know how big that is. One of the things that this text shows us, and we should take from it, is that it uses images and patterns. place in the world that looks like this. It uses these things that are found throughout the Near East, throughout the ancient world. We see this sort of thing going on. And it uses those things like pillars and the lily that's described as the shape of the sea and the shape on the top of the capitals and the bulls and the cherubim and the pomegranates, little bell-type things. It uses all of those things. It uses even the construction, the sort of the shape of the temple and the ratios of all the sizes and things. It uses them to speak to a godly truth. You know, so when we look at these cherubim, which are not cute little chubby angels, they're sort of winged beasts. Remember, it's a cherubim that scares off Adam and Eve from the Garden of Eden. I somehow suspect a fat, cute little roly-poly baby with little goose wings, you know, isn't going to scare anybody off. Especially a snake-handling woman like Eve. These are sort of powerful beasts. It's an image of that we see elsewhere in the ancient world. Sort of think sphinx or winged lions or something along those lines. It's a way of talking about the fact that our God exists in this supernatural realm that is beyond anything that we can imagine, but we have to try and imagine it anyway. You know, it's as much the goose wing wings is what the angels have. Well, no, but we can't really describe what they have, so we do the best we can. As I've said, it's one of the problems when you read Revelation, is that it's using earthly language to describe heavenly realities. The temple is showing this in the ancient world. And so it uses all the things that we see. Take, for instance, the pillars. There are pillars all over the place in the ancient world, in temples and in palaces and in all sorts of places. And usually they're fertility symbols and they're showing how great things are and such. These are technologically miraculous pillars or marvelous pillars, I should say. They're not miraculous, but they're a technological feat. Usually, you want something that's a big, tall pillar in the ancient world that's made out of wood. These are cast bronze, probably made in segments that stack together and look like it's all one big, massive thing. Bronze in itself, I mean, just as it says, you can't measure how much bronze is used. Bronze, for those of you who don't remember your high school chemistry class, is 90% copper, 10% tin. Okay, well that's pretty straightforward. I'll just go to the store and pick up some copper and some tin and make some. Except that tin only comes from a few places, and one of the places that you get tin in the ancient world is England. That's why the Romans go to England, is to get the tin that's there, that it's useful. Oh, it becomes a lot bigger deal to have all this stuff brought in and made. It's an impressive thing that Solomon is doing to show off. Anyway, that he's using these things and he's taking them to the extreme as a way of showing, well, yes, you guys use this to represent, you know, something fairly common and base, but I'm showing you that these things are standing in for the power of God, which is more powerful than just sort of natural existence. He's using, he's elevating these bulls that you have them, you know, the groups of them looking north, south, east, and west. You know, this the symbolism, you know, maybe 12 tribes, or maybe it certainly has in all directions. These things, again, they're motifs, they're images, they're designs that you see elsewhere in the ancient world. But here they're serving to show that our God is not only, you know, our God can compete with the other gods. Our God can't be outdone by them. And so Solomon makes this amazing, beautiful temple. And I think there's something to the fact that we have verse or chapter 7 here, which follows chapter 6. Yeah, I know. Ooh. But in chapter 6, what we have is the construction of the temple. Remember, David wants to, up until this point, the ark has been sort of floating around, and it, occasionally gets captured. It's, living in the tabernacle, the sort of portable tent that God made, and or God instructed the Israelites to make, and they move around. There's this desire for some stability, for a place to a central place of worship. And David doesn't get to make the temple, but Solomon does. And he makes the temple in the description of him making the temple is in chapter 6. It takes him 7 years to make the temple. And then it takes him 13 years to make his palace. And I think there's something to that about, and now his palace is actually bigger than the temple. So it makes sense that it takes a little bit longer. And it's, described snazzily. I think there's something about that ordering your life, ordering your priorities, figuring out, putting the first things first, and then enjoying your blessings, enjoying things that God gives you. Solomon has this big thing. He has it because God gave it to him. He's built the temple of God. He's had that burden. He's done that. He's built it snazzily, and now he builds his house. He builds a space for this thing and a space for that. Again, there's this. It's detailed, but it's not so detailed that you can recreate it. I went looking for images of Solomon's palace. Can't find them. Solomon's temple. Oh yeah, that's way detailed, but I couldn't find images of Solomon's palace. It's not actually that big. Let me just read it again. It's 75 feet wide, the church is about 40 feet wide, long wall, so a little bit bigger. But, some of us went to high school, so. I think there's something there about recognizing just how amazingly blessed we are. But, remember when Jesus says about not worrying, look to the lilies of the field, because Solomon, all his splendor, was not as arrayed as though they are, they neither toil nor sin. That scripture, I'm jumbling up. You and I, get to hang out in a lot bigger buildings than Solomon ever did. We have quite a bit more wealth than was ever, the wealthiest guy in the ancient world. I think there's something there that we need to meditate on and think about. I think there's also something to the fact that the way that you have the description of the temple, he builds that, he builds his house, and then you get Hiram, this guy who has the same name as the king. I wonder if all the people who are named Donald right now are going by their middle names or something. He has the same name as the king, but the author of Kings wants to be clear, it's not the king of Tyre, Hiram, it's another Hiram whose mother was from Naphtali and his father was a bronze worker, and he comes and he does these things. Now, for those of you who are Bible scholars or had the same bar mitzvah text that I did, when you read about Hiram, Bezalel, the craftsman that God used, that God sends to Moses, who builds all the stuff for the tabernacle, resonates because the descriptions are similar about their guys who have all these skills and things. Hiram comes, and like I said, from my reading of this, I see this as sort of a latter part, either temple was built, but it wasn't fully furnished, or somewhere along the process, Solomon, picks up this, knows about this Hiram guy and hires him and has him come down and do all this work. And he uses these guys. I think there's something there about leaving some room for improvement or looking for the next thing, to recognize that our work is not always done. And so there's this way that he finds this guy who does this great work and says, oh, I want to use him on the temple things as well. He doesn't settle for second best. Again, if you think about all the bronze and all the work and all the things that are going on, this is just the furnishings, right? We normally think about building and, oh, yeah, they finally got the roof up. Well, we know from here, we got the roof up in a year. So it was 10 years to get all the furnishings and the trim work and the this and that, the light switches, and right? We know it's all this inner stuff that takes a long time. The outer stuff, not so much. There's probably a whole other sermon there, isn't it? The outward stuff can be changed pretty quickly, but the inward stuff takes a long time. What's more important? It's the stuff you use every day. The third thing, I think, with this text is that you can't do it all. Think about this. Solomon, the wisest man in the whole of all of history, the guy that God blesses with, his origin story is he gets blessed with supernatural wisdom, right? If you were a comic book. Solomon is the wisest guy ever. He writes the book of Proverbs, but he can't do it all. He has to hire Hiram to come make this stuff. And Hiram is apparently an amazing metalworker. He's incredibly gifted and talented. Again, he parallels Bezalel. Moses, the guy who walks with God so much that his face glows. And when people look at him, they go, oh, Moses, you've been hanging out with the Lord Almighty too much. Moses can't do it all. So God says, Bezalel and Aholiab to do the work that Moses can. I think there's something else here that we tend to think about certain things, oh, that's spiritual, and oh, that's practical. Right? We used to have two boards, one dealt with spiritual matters, one dealt with practical matters. But then we just had the discussion that, well, what, is how you spend your money a spiritual matter? So one of the things that this shows us is that all professions, all work, can have can glorify God. We sometimes think about, sort of spiritual stuff as being clean and, sort of white collary and up in the mind and maybe writing, the dirtiest you get is from some smudges when you write fancy ideas on a piece of paper. I mean, this guy cast so much bronze they can't weigh it. Which is particularly impressive when you think about other places in the Bible that you get massive amounts of weight of gold and silver and all these sorts of things. I mean, think about all the mining that had to go on, all the digging. And this wasn't, sitting in an air-conditioned cab, moving a joystick mining. This was all the wood that had to be, the charcoal that had to be made, the wood that had to be cut down and made into charcoal in order to heat the bronze up, to heat the tin and the copper up hot enough. I mean, that's some hot work. A couple days ago, it was 90 degrees. Well, a few days before that, it was 70 degrees. I'm like, oh, I'm getting the chainsaw out, doing all these projects outside. Then it got to 90. I'm like, nope, not going to do anything. This is a lot of work in some 90-degree days. There's a lot of blood, sweat, and tears to go into this. There's a lot of schlepping from point A to point B. When I was a mover, I used to think that may be one of the most unglorious jobs ever. to stuff. There's a lovely parallel between those people who create things and the way they emulate the Creator and the act of creation, that seven-day, the narrative of Genesis, the 7 days of creation, and God making all these things with his hands and blowing and speaking. There's a way that people who manipulate matter, people who do stuff are worshiping God with it and can use their skills and things to do it. And there's something to this that speaks and reminds us of the incarnation of Jesus Christ coming to this earth as a carpenter's son. He's a construction worker. He's a stonemason. He's a builder. Coming to us to be a master craftsman for us, to build us something that we can't build. Only this time, instead of it being this massive bronze marble, he crafts for us a life that we would not be able to build on our own. Hiram builds for Solomon. He builds all these furnishings and all these things for the temple of God in Jerusalem on the north side of Mount Zion. He builds this place where God will dwell among his people, this umbilical cord between this world and heaven. Jesus Christ comes into our lives and builds a house, builds a life, builds a place that God dwells with us in our hearts. All that temple work, all that temple language, all that ideas about the divine being with us,